Good morning. Welcome to the Biblical Reflection for the 17th Sunday in the Ordinary Time, Year A. The reading is from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 13, verses 44-52. It's the third and the last part of the collection of the parables in the Gospel according to Matthew. Commonly, they are considered three parables. The first two ones twin parables about the treasure and about the pearl, the third one about the net, and possibly the concluding formula in verse 52 we could also consider as a parable because it has the features of a parabolic saying. Let us now see some matters of translation. The three parables are introduced in the same way by the kingdom of heaven is like. This introducing formula is preceded in the second and the third parable by an adverb translated by again. In the first parable, the object of comparison is the treasure, with the complement that it is found by a man. In the second parable, the object is a man, a merchant, who is searching the good defined purse. And in the third parable, the object of comparison is a net. Regarding the second parable of a merchant searching fine pearls, the double Greek substantive noun is translated just by a word, a merchant. While in Greek we have firstly a general term, a man, as in the previous parable, followed by a particular noun specifying this man, who he is, that is a merchant. Looking now at the concluding statement in verse 52, the introducing formula, the kingdom of heaven is like, is also followed by double noun. Firstly, a man, which is specified by the term a householder. Regarding the first two twin parables, the effect of finding is expressed in a very similar way. That he goes, sells, and buys. On one hand, buys the field, on other hand, buys the pearl. Regarding the Greek adjectives qualifying the pearls translated here by fine, it is the same one which is later on translated in verse 48 by the good ones, and also the same adjective in Greek is used for the good land soil in the parable of the sower and the good seeds in the parable of the weeds. The same adjective kalos in Matthew is used also as referring to good trees, good fruits, good deeds. Therefore, we could say that the stress here is not on external beauty, but of internal goodness, moral goodness. Regarding verse 37, the Greek text says only generally that the net is gathering of every kind without specifying what. Many translations add of fish, but we could also presume that the net collects not only any sea animal, but even any item, even any rubbish. Therefore, in verse 48, there is a contrast between the good ones, that is what is suitable, what's supposed to be collected, and the rotten ones, translating literally the Greek term, which also refers to the tree that is not bad, but is rotten and produces evil fruits. Here we have the rotten ones, so something what is undesirable, something what did not supposed to be collected at all. The parable of the net is considered also as relating to the explanation of the parable of the weeds, because it has the common elements as the temporary expression at the end of the age, not of the world. And then verse 50 entirely is similar, the same as verse 42, which is also found at the end of the explanation of the parable of the weeds, with the statement referring to the final judgment. The question in verse 51, have you understood all this, goes back to the discussion and question of the disciples after the parable of the sower, when they asked Jesus about the reason why he speaks in parables. Jesus answers them, to you is given the understanding of the kingdom, but to them is not. It means the others are unable to understand because of their failure, because of the hardening of their hearts, while the disciples are open and receiving the words of Jesus. The last matter of translation, in verse 49, the separation is not simply of the evil ones from the righteous ones, but there's also a important Greek word meaning the middle. So the evil ones are separated from the middle of the righteous ones, because it recalls the sowing of the weeds in the middle of the wheat. In both cases is used the same Greek word meaning middle. As the weeds are sown in the middle of the wheat, it is that the evil one wants the good one also to fail, because this is the nature of the sin that wants to divide people. As in the original sin, Adam answers to God, excusing himself, she has given me. So he divides himself now from the woman. The twin parable of the treasure and the pearl, those two sayings are so similar, and there is a rule in the interpretation of the biblical text. When the two sayings are so similar, we should not focus so much what makes them similar, but we should look for the elements which differentiate them, because where is the difference, there could be the key for the interpretation. The parable of the treasure mentions joy, while the parable of the pearl does not mention it, even if it is implicit, because in both cases the man sells whatever he has to buy the item. This joy is the expression of discovering, of understanding the value of the kingdom that is more precious than anything else. Because in the preceding parables of the mustard seed, the kingdom at the beginning seemed to be too small. In the parable of the yeast of the leaven, the kingdom of the heaven was hidden in the flower. Now this kingdom is discovered, appears. Joy as the reaction of discovering the kingdom is not sufficient, because it reminds us and links it with the parable of the sower. In the explanation we read that the seed sown on rocky ground is the one who hears the word and receives it at once with joy. In both cases we have joy, but the person who hears the word with joy is not constant, is unstable, is not enduring when comes the tribulation and persecution. Therefore, the parable of the pearl has this additional element comparing to the parable of the treasure, that this man is seeking to find the good pearls. This word seeking expresses all his efforts, all his energy, dedication, in order to find good pearls, valuable pearls. So each parable adds some elements to the understanding of the kingdom. And these two parables, even if they are similar, but they are also complementary. The joy, which could be only temporary, lasting for a short time, is complemented by the endurance of the merchant, which is searching for the good pearls. And this aspect of endurance links the first two parables with the third one, which is about the judgment. Because The good ones will be separated from the evil ones only at the last time, at the end of the age. During their earthly life, they will be exposed to temptations because the evil ones will be living in the middle of them, in their midst. And this aspect of endurance and in the perspective of the final judgment, it can be also illustrated by another parable in the Gospel according to Matthew about the wedding banquet in the chapter 22, where appears a man not wearing a wedding robe. This person without a wedding robe represents all those who follow Jesus, all Christians who begin the journey with Jesus following him, but they are not constant. On the way, somehow they disappear because of persecution, because of any kind of distraction. Therefore, they could be linked similar to the unfruitful kinds of soil in the proverb, in the parable of the sower. Both parables of the wedding banquet and our parable of the net have a character of a warning, because following of Jesus is not a matter of a part-time, it's a matter of full-time engagement. Now, going to the concluding statement in verse 52, which myself I considered also as a parable, where the every scribe can refer to the old ones, and becoming the disciple refers to the new ones. So we have this chiastic arrangement, relation of these two expressions. This relation between the new ones and the old ones can recall the double parable which is present in all synoptics, Matthew, Mark and Luke, about putting new unshrunk cloth on the old garment and putting new wine into old wineskins, with the result that the new wine requires to be put into new wineskins. In this double statement, the newness is Jesus and his teaching, which cannot be put into old form of the Judaic religion, of the Pharisaistic interpretation and religiosity. It requires completely a new form. Here in our concluding final parable, the scribe who becomes the disciples of the kingdom needs to bring from the treasure the new and the old one. So there is not a conflict, contrast, but there is complementarity. God's word revealed in the Old Testament needs to be also brought out, as well also the teaching of Jesus. Both are valuable for Jesus' followers. In fact, Jesus himself teaches that he did not come to abolish the law or the prophets, but to fulfill it. And Jesus is insisting, explaining the disciples that their righteousness should be of higher standard, exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees. Jesus criticizes the scribes and the Pharisees for sticking to the letter of the law and forgetting about the spirit of the law. Jesus himself gives so many examples how to interpret the law in the spirit of the law. As for example, if we would continue our reading in the chapter 5 of the Gospel according to Matthew, Jesus refers to the interpretation of the law, that to love the neighbor but to hate the enemies. Jesus challenges this statement, this interpretation of the law, this tradition, by stating that we should love, pray and do good to all those who hate us, who harm us. This is the radical change. This is what Jesus calls the righteousness should exceed the one of the scribes and the Pharisees. Therefore, the disciples should be like the scribes, but now of the new kingdom, of the kingdom of heaven, that will bring both the teaching of Jesus as well the words of God of the Old Testament, interpreting them in the spirit of the law, in the spirit of God's inspiration, as Jesus taught us. Wishing a nice day, nice weekend, and blessed Sunday.